So I've got a nephew. He's 5 years old, and I recently found out that he's really into swords, because swords are awesome. And I said to his dad, my brother, hey, could I make the boy a wooden sword for Christmas? And my brother was like, yeah, go crazy. And so I was very excited about this. But then immediately I sort of ran into a problem, because I was thinking about the design and I thought, well, why are swords cool? Why are they fun to play with? Well, because you can kill and maim people with them. They're pointy, and they've got sharp edges, and they've got lots of bits sticking out of them, and all the things that make them exciting are also the things that make them incredibly dangerous. And so I thought to myself, well, I've got to make something that's cool and fun and looks like you could kill somebody with it, but is safe enough for a 5-year-old. Yeah, no problem. So the obvious approach here is just to get a sword and make a copy of it out of wood. But this turns out to be a terrible idea. This isn't a real sword, it's a reproduction, but it's enough to get the point across. I can't just make this out of wood. For one thing, it's much too thin. If I made the blade like this, it would be really likely to break. And a broken sword is way more dangerous than a real sword when it's made out of wood, because you'd have a very splintery end, and that could really hurt somebody. This one obviously also has a sharp point. That's no good. It's got a relatively sharp edge. Sharp enough, that's no good. It's got a lot of bits that stick out of it too far, so if you're playing, you could easily catch somebody else or even catch yourself across the face. I loved making wooden weapons when I was a kid, and I seriously can't even count the number of times that I hit myself in the face with, like, homemade nunchucks or something. You did it too, don't pretend. So I have to make something that looks like this, but it's got to be thicker, it's got to be strong, it can't have any sharp edges or points, and it needs to be lightweight enough that a young kid can swing it around, and it's also not gonna hurt somebody too badly if they get, you know, whacked in the noggin with it. So I started out with a piece of white oak, and I made a basic outline in Photoshop and just printed it out full size, pasted it on there with Super 77 adhesive, and the piece is about 3/4 of an inch thick because I want it to be strong. I also gave myself a center line. This is surprisingly similar to furniture making, where just knowing where the center of things is really helpful pretty much the whole time. Before I did anything else, I wanted to get some shaping done to the actual blade itself. So I took this round router bit, it's called a core box bit, I put that into my mortising jig in my router, and you can see me just tipping it into the blade here, and I'm going to go all the way up to the tip, and then I'm going to come back to the cross guard with it. And what I'm just doing here is making a thing called a fuller. And you see this on a lot of antique weapons, especially European weapons, and they come in a lot of shapes and sizes. And the basic idea is you remove some material, but you still keep the strength and the stiffness. It's a lot like an I-beam. Now I wanted to get the hilt sorted out, and so I'm just cutting down to the line with a dovetail saw, and then I'm going to take the waste out with the bandsaw. It's definitely the quickest way to get something like this removed. Now moving on to the cross piece, and I'm going to mortise out the middle of that so I can just slip it right over the tang of the sword. And I'm mortising this out just like I would a piece of furniture. I did the waste on the drill press, and now I'm going in with a chisel. It's no different than something I would do for a chair or a table. So here's the completed piece. I did end up widening out the mortise later so that the sword could be full width the whole way through and not be weakened anywhere. And this is just the template I have for the guard, and I'm pasting that on so that I'll have a guideline for shaping it. I decided to do the shaping on the lathe because it seemed like it would be the quickest and give me the smoothest results. I'm using a detail gouge here, and I had kind of a slightly complicated design, but I abandoned that, and I just went with a real smooth curve from the center down to the edges, and then I did a specific diameter right on the ends, because when it's done, I'm gonna slip over these bolsters made of copper. I just sliced these off of copper pipe, and they make it look nicer, and they're also gonna protect the edges of the guard from any splintering or damage. I like the turning so much, I decided to do the same thing with the hilt, but I need to thicken that up first. So here I am just adding some pieces of wood to the hilt and a little bit below, and then I'm gonna chuck it up in the lathe.
lathe. This is where having a center line and leaving the whole thing rectangular is really helpful. Having that line and those crisp corners helps me get it registered in the chuck and then bring up the tailstock accurately so the whole thing is spinning true. My basic hilt design is simple, and so I'm just using a roughing gouge for most of it. I want a swell in the middle where your hand is going to grab it, and then it needs to be narrow on either end of that. So it's not very difficult to turn. And then down at the bottom, I'm going to make this little bead detail.
Real swords have this too. It's called the pommel, and it keeps your hand from slipping out or from throwing the sword accidentally, especially if your hand is slick with sweat and blood. Or if you're a 5-year-old boy and your hand is slick with, I don't know, pudding?
Once that's finished, I'm going to use the skew chisel to texture the hilt, and that's going to improve the grip and just make it look cooler. Now, you might be interested in turning, and if you haven't gotten into it yet, you should look at my book, 1 Week to Wood Turning. It's a complete introduction to getting all the gear you need to set up and turning. I cover lathes, tools, grinding, studio setup, safety, fire safety, dust collection, and everything else you need to know. If you're interested, go to rexkruger.com/book and you can learn more about it. Now that I've got a lot of my machine work done, I don't need the square profile anymore, so I'm actually going to cut out the blade shape on the bandsaw and cut the piece to the correct length. Now the bandsaw blade I'm using is pretty rough, and so the surface needs a lot of refinement. For that, I'm just going with a standard hand plane. Then I go in and clean up the point and give it a smooth curve from the blade up to the tip.
If you'd like to follow along with this build, you can grab the tip sheet. It's sort of like an article and a set of plans all together in one single page. It's got notes on the build, measurements for everything that I did, links to all the tools that I used, and it's completely free. Just go to rexkruger.com/articles or click the link.
Now I want to mimic some of the beveling that you'd have on an actual blade, so I'm going in with a roundover bit in my router and then also refining that with a random orbital sander. I also don't like the way the fullers begin and end really abruptly, so especially up at the tip, I'm going to blend those in with just a regular gouge, and then I'm going to come in with some sandpaper, and that's going to give me a much nicer transition from the hard machine line of the router bit to the smoother section of the point. I gave a lot of thought to how I wanted to have the cross piece actually attached to the blade. And what I finally came up with was just splitting it in half to get it on there and glue it on. So I'm going in very carefully on the diagonal with a Japanese pull saw here, going very slowly so it doesn't break out. And then I'm mixing up a little bit of epoxy, and then I'm going to take the sander and put some of the sanding dust directly from sanding the sword right in there, and that's going to give me a thick paste that's going to dry to a better color. I get the cross piece fitted on there and clamped up, and then I add some extra epoxy to fill any gaps that I've got, and then this is what it looks like. I let it dry overnight for maximum strength. And then I wasn't really happy with the blade and how chunky it was down near the guard, so here I am just refining it and making it narrower. You might call this the ricasso.
If this were, you know, an actual blade.
And then you can see that I have a line here where I did the cutting of the cross guard, and I'm not happy with that, so I'm just adding a piece of shop-made veneer, very easy to stick on with super glue, and then I trim it off with a little Stanley pocket knife, and once I've got it roughed out, I just take some sandpaper stuck to a piece of scrap wood and blend everything together so that veneer looks like a nice natural decoration of the sword. Once I've got that fixed, I just need a couple of coats of clear lacquer, and so I'm really happy with the way this came out. It looks like a sword that I would have loved to have as a kid. It looks fun to play with, but I also preserved that basic safety I was looking for. There's no sharp edges, nothing sticks out too far, there are no points. You can keep a good grip on it, it's not very likely to fly out of your hand, and the metal details, I added a little steel bolster down there below the pommel, all of that stuff just increases the cool factor, and it makes it a more fun toy to play with. And this is something that I feel really comfortable giving to my nephew. It's going to be a good gift.
So, I'm always thinking about how I fund this channel and keep my business going. One thing that occurred to me recently is that if just 10% of my subscribers gave me $2 a month, then I could demonetize all of my videos, give all my plans away for free, I'd never have to sell another t-shirt or anything else. and I could make more, better videos. That's if just 10% of people gave $2 a month. What do I have right now? I have about 0.5% of my subscribers helping to support this channel, and I'm extremely grateful for those people. But if we could get that number up just a little bit more, I could make more higher quality videos and give more content away for free. So if you're interested in kicking in a little bit of money and supporting this content, go over to patreon.com/rexkruger and check out the early access, the rewards, and the exclusive content that I have just for my patrons. And if you are one of the 99% of people who watches these videos without supporting and you can't afford to, don't feel the slightest bit guilty. Don't let it trouble you. Happy New Year, and thanks so much for watching.